Tom Drummond.
And cases to wrap up by the end of an hour. So it's probably not surprising that I feel a kind of connection to Telly Savalas. He was born here in New York. I was born in the Bronx. He made movies. I make movies. He played a New York detective. Well, you know the rest. The TV series Kojak broke a lot of new ground. At a time when most cop shows were shooting on back lots, they shot a considerable amount of footage on the streets of New York. Kind of like another detective show I'm quite fond of. And of course, audiences had never seen a character who quite looked or behaved like Kojak. Why was the character so popular? I think Telly Savalas described it best. Probably because Kojak was so much like him. As he put it, he operates on instinct and decency. But if you give him any lip, he'll throw you out a window.
In the decade of disco and drugs, pop stars and pop art, one icon emerged from the pack. He wasn't the most handsome or even the most famous, but for 5 years on television during the 1970s, Telly Savalas was one of the most watched, playing a New York detective named Theo Kojak.
Still with the Italian suits, I see.
Well, very happy you noticed.
When he walked into a room, Sinatra had that, and he had it. Everything really stopped.
You can't admit to yourself that he's innocent. You want to know why? Because to admit it, you'd have to admit how corrupt you really are.
Telly had the ability to move me as an actor. Very few actors do.
When are you gonna find the medicine for my birds? They're dropping like flies.
He had a look about him that said, I'm all man.
He loved women. He loved all kinds of women. It was his favorite drug.
Telly was a winner. Everything he did, and he had to win. He had to win.
Hey, fish. Loves you, baby.
Hollywood, 1963. At the 35th Annual Academy Awards, Best Supporting Actor nominee Telly Savalas waits anxiously for the winner to be announced. He is 40. And incredibly has been acting for only 5 years. As the envelope is opened, Telly knows his life is about to change. Where he goes from here is up to him. Aristotle Telly Savalas was born on January 21st, 1923, the second son of Greek immigrants. He grew up on the streets of New York during the harsh realities of the Depression. Telly's mother, Catherine, was an artist. His father, Nicholas, owned some restaurants. Family meant everything to the Savalas clan, in good times and bad.
My father was a very wealthy man at one time. And during the crash of 1929, I believe, he lost everything. And we were not really impoverished, but there were tough times following that. The Great Depression.
The Depression broke many men's spirits, but not Nick Savalas's. He moved his family into a rundown apartment above his remaining restaurant and encouraged his children, four boys and a girl, to find strength in their Greek heritage. In fact, until he went to grammar school, Telly spoke only Greek.
My father had a big strap in the kitchen and a sign right next to it, and it said, whoever speaks English in this house gets this.
Telly was a good-natured kid and the bright star of the family. Like many boys, he was in constant competition with his older brother, Gus. Towards his younger brothers, George and Teddy, he was more protective. From his father, Telly learned to weather adversity with a devil-may-care attitude and a healthy dose of deception. The elder Savalas was a charismatic con man, capable of charging unsuspecting tourists 25 cents to walk on a public beach that was free. Pulling a fast one or exaggerating the truth appealed to young Telly's mischievous nature. From his mother, a talented artist, Telly inherited a spiritual sensibility. His easy charm and cocky personality, however, was all his own.
Telly had such a wonderful way with people. I mean, everyone he met, it was just, you just felt as though you've known him forever.
From an early age, Telly worked, but never with a career in mind. In high school, he entertained the idea of becoming a psychiatrist. Human behavior fascinated Telly, and he'd often make outrageous comments just to get a reaction. Though friends labeled him a kidder, he was deeply sensitive. Once, as a lifeguard, he failed to save a man from drowning and was troubled by the memory forever after. During World War II, the patriotic Telly joined the Army. He trained to be a medic, but facts about his wartime experience are sketchy. One story reports he went to Europe where he was wounded. Another says he was in South Africa. There were rumors he was a spy. In truth, he never left the United States. Military records now reveal that at age 20, Telly landed in an Army hospital after a serious car accident while on leave in Virginia.
And when I saw him later on at the hospital, and soon after he recovered, I said, "Telly, exactly what went through your Army career?" He said, "Let's not talk about it. Forget it." He never wanted to talk about it. That was the mystery.
Telly spent almost a year in recovery. Upon his discharge from the Army in 1944, he enrolled at Columbia University, where he took courses in psychology. He was a half-hearted student, still unsure of a direction in life, when he met a young woman at a Greek-American dance.
I thought he was very handsome and charming. And, of course, I was impressed. I came from a very strict family. They didn't allow you to go out with anyone.
Catherine Nikolaidis was only 17 when she snuck out of her parents' house for a night on the town with the 23-year-old Savalas. He took her for drinks at the Plaza Hotel and on a carriage ride in Central Park.
He always made you feel good. He always had that knack. He would make you think that you were the most beautiful person in the world.
In 1948, after 2 years of dating, Telly and Catherine were married and moved into a New York apartment. Sadly, though, while on his honeymoon, Telly learned that his father had died from bladder cancer. Nicholas Savalas, the hero of Telly's childhood, was gone, and no con job in the world could bring him back. At 24, Telly was still in college, broke, and living off his wife.
I was working two jobs to keep the family going, plus my mother was living with us.
Telly quit college and went to work. He was 26 and with a new responsibility, fatherhood. He and Catherine named their daughter Christina after Telly's mother.
My mom was probably the breadwinner of the family because he was just out of school. He always slept late in the morning. I remember as a little girl always going into the bedroom and jumping on him and sitting on his stomach, and he could never quite wake up.
In 1952, after a collection of dead-end jobs, Telly found one worth waking up for at the New York Bureau of the U.S. Information Agency's Voice of America. At 28, with no previous announcing experience, Telly had talked his way into an on-air position, hosting a show called Telly's Coffee House.
Hello, this is the Voice of America in New York, and this is Telly with my standard Saturday invitation to join me at the Coffee House.
It was sort of a propaganda show that would be broadcast throughout Europe.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to meet the very talented, the very beautiful, the very nervous, and the very shy, Ava Gardner. Well, do you feel better now, Ava?
I'm terribly shy, and therefore this sort of thing right now, I'm terrified. Just doing this with you. So I'm not cut out for this sort of thing. I'm going to be much better.
I can't believe it, dear. Amazing. You know, your husband Frank Sinatra was in the coffee house last week, and I want you to tell me, Ava, were you a Sinatra fan before you met Frank?
Now, he's there a short time, and he rocks the place.
people and I was working there at the time myself. And they used to come to me and say, your brother is amazing.
But now it's time to say goodbye. Goodbye. Did you know that goodbye really means God be with you? Well, all right. I just wanted to make sure you understood when I say, this is Telly at the coffee house saying goodbye.
So far in life, Telly had gotten by on charisma alone. It hadn't earned him much of a living. But now he saw a chance to strike it big in showbiz. He thought he'd be a theatrical producer, so he started putting on plays in nearby Stamford, Connecticut. Immediately, he lost money and couldn't pay his bills. Fleeing his creditors and his wife, Telly hid out in Garden City, Long Island with his mother. He had also started an affair with a young actress named Joan Hackett.
Telly had the way of always being involved with somebody. I mean, getting involved. Women didn't leave him alone. It did make things difficult.
The affairs, plus the financial debt, forced Telly's marriage to the brink.
I was almost losing the house then, and the cars, and whatever we had, because of this Connecticut playhouse. So it was best to part.
In 1957, Catherine divorced Telly. He was 34, broke, and living with his mother. For the charismatic young man who had been the star of the Savalas family, life couldn't have been more bleak. Fortunately, his mother knew someone in the local government, and for $3 an hour, 2 hours a week, Telly was back in show business, directing amateur plays for the Garden City Community Theater.
Into this auditorium strode a young Mr. Telly Savalas, who was, as they say, between engagements, and brought with him a vitality, an enthusiasm, a joie de vivre, which really, really vitalized the group.
He was not good looking, but he was very charismatic. And even before he was famous, women were very attracted to Telly.
One of those women was a shy young grammar school teacher who sat in the back of the room.
And there was the guy sitting in the room, kind of balding and big nose, and I usually just mark my papers. I could not take my eyes off him. I just couldn't stop looking at him. Wow.
Telly couldn't believe Lynn was 22. She looked too young. But he asked her out, and soon they were dating.
He was exciting and dramatic, and it was fun.
Telly was happy with Lynn and felt he'd found a home directing plays at the Garden City Little Theater. It was just the kind of place to reinvent himself and start anew. But he was also restless. He needed a career big enough for his oversized personality and began thinking about acting. After all, he'd been acting most of his life.
You're watching Telly Savalas, part of Watching the Detectives Week on Biography.
You see what Duvall did yesterday?
Yeah.
He shouldn't.
In odd jobs, he was also directing plays for a community theater. What hadn't changed was his secretive nature. When pressed, he still refused to talk about his experiences in World War II, even to his new girlfriend, Lynn Gardner.
I was under the impression he was a spy. But I don't know. He glossed over things effectively.
I think that he showed the world one person, but I think if you really wanted to get to know him, I think that was very, very closed area.
He always used to say he was kind of a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and you know, that there was a side of him that maybe we shouldn't know.
Whatever the reasons behind his secretive behavior, it only added to his mystique. He liked to fool people. Even the casting agent who called one day looking for an actor to play a Greek judge in a TV drama.
So my mother says, Telly, why don't you go for it? So sure enough, Telly goes down and auditions for this part. Well, they thought he just got off the banana boat.
And he acts like he can't speak English very well. And he says something like, the script. And they give him a script and they said, well, I guess he was the only one that showed up.
At 35, Telly had bluffed his way into his first professional acting job. The producer, David Susskind, was so impressed that he hired Telly again, this time to play gangster Lucky Luciano in a live television drama called The Witness. It was a performance people noticed.
He just jumped out of the screen. My impression of him was that he was the Humphrey Bogart type, not your typically handsome at all, by far, and yet totally sexual, sexy, and charismatic.
About the same time, another casting agent introduced Telly to the director of an upcoming movie called The Young Savages, starring Burt Lancaster. In typical Telly fashion, the director was led to believe Telly was not an actor, but a high school English teacher.
I said, look, I don't want to meet an English teacher from Forest Hills High School. I need a great actor that's going to go up against Burt Lancaster. It's my first job with a huge star. I'm not going to even talk about some school teacher from Forest Hills High School. Well, she was a very tough lady. Finally, I said, all right, I'll meet the teacher from Forest Hills High School, and in walked Telly Savalas. He had a huge aura about him. I mean, there was this karma that he gave off, and I just knew it was okay.
By letting others believe he was just an English teacher, Telly had exceeded everyone's expectations. He was cast in The Young Savages as a police detective who, with Burt Lancaster, confronts a violent New York street gang.
They're all alike. They all say the same thing. My son didn't do it. My son couldn't do it. My son is a good boy. They all believe it, too.
Without ever having taken an acting class, Telly, at age 36, was suddenly working in the big leagues.
My father felt that show business was a razzle-dazzle thing, and it was all pretty fake. And he was the luckiest guy in the world to have been given the opportunity to make a lot of money, to have so much fun. And it was an accident.
He thought he acted all his life, only this was for money. And one of the things he said many times is, someday they're going to find me out and send me home.
Instead, Telly was sought after by theatrical agents looking for more natural types. It was the era of gritty social dramas, and actors had to look real, not pretty.
He was like a bull in a china store. He was so awesome in the sense that he'd walk in and take over a room. He was bigger than life.
As production on The Young Savages drew to a close, Telly asked Lynn to marry him. There were stories of other women in Telly's life, but Lynn either never heard the rumors or discounted them. Soon after their wedding in 1960, Lynn gave birth to a daughter, Penelope, and the new family settled in Los Angeles. Telly was working steadily in TV guest roles and enjoying the fruits of his paycheck. It was nice compensation for those years growing up poor. In 1962, Burt Lancaster picked Telly to play his cellmate in Birdman of Alcatraz, based on the true story of a death row inmate who became a respected ornithologist.
You be careful, take it easy, and don't mash him.
Once more, the director was John Frankenheimer.
There was stuff with Telly's bird getting sick that I thought he did a beautiful job with. It's hard stuff to do, and he just did it terribly well.
Where are you going to find the medicine for my birds? They're dropping like flies.
Telly had the ability to move me as an actor. Very few actors do.
I'm going to kill them all.
In 1963, Telly received a supporting actor nomination for his role in Birdman of Alcatraz. His family was ecstatic. Only his brother Gus, now a Foreign Service officer, dismissed the story as just another one of Telly's tall tales.
Well, I thought there was the usual family propaganda, you know. And especially when I'm in Libya someplace, and they say he's up for an Academy Award, he's been nominated. I said, I mean, let's tone it down, shall we? But it was true.
The most glamorous affair in glamorous Hollywood draws a glittering crowd. The 35th Annual Academy Awards.
We went. It was unbelievable. Stars, I sat right behind Patty Duke. And it was just unbelievable. I mean, didn't win, but wow. I mean, right out of the box, is first major picture, and there he is.
At 38, Telly had won recognition as a fine actor. His father would have been proud. Without ever taking an acting class, his son had conned his way into the movies.
Telly enjoyed the acting, but he also enjoyed what came with it. The acting was another avenue to achieve for his family, as well as to achieve that acceptance, if you want to say, that stardom will give you.
In spite of the acceptance, Telly harbored fears of failure. His father had lost his fortune in the Great Depression, and Telly was very much his father's son.
And he said, you know, he said, I'm going to make it big in Hollywood. He said, and then I'm going to blow it. And I've never forgotten that quote.
Telly was a man full of fears, most of which he kept to himself. Acting was his shield. Whether he played in lighthearted comedies like Love is a Ball or intense psychological thrillers like Cape Fear. In spite of his anxieties, Telly took risks. Luck and talent had played their parts in his success, but he had also shown a gambler's nerve. For his next performance, he'd gamble again, betting his career with the last hairs on his head. Savalas turned 40. He'd been acting for only 5 years, and already he'd been nominated for an Oscar. Now, he was about to start work on a biblical epic called The Greatest Story Ever Told, playing Pontius Pilate, the harsh governor of Judea who condemns Jesus to death.
So he gets on the phone and he says, Mama, I've got a part in The Greatest Story Ever Told. Oh, you'll make a wonderful Jesus, my son. Says, Mama, I'm not playing Jesus, I'm playing Pontius Pilate. Well, whatever it is, my son, be sympathetic.
The director, George Stevens, suggested Telly shave his head for the role. He agreed, but asked that his children be witness to the momentous occasion so they wouldn't be frightened when he returned home bald.
He didn't want this to be a traumatic thing, and we knew it was him. We could have cared less.
I thought it was very cool. I thought it made him look younger and not kind of sort of old man-ish. But we liked it. We liked rubbing his head and sort of fun to watch him shave every day.
I thought, fine, it looks good. And then he realized how handy this is and never grew his hair back.
The Savalas look was born. It took a lot of guts to walk around bald in the era of hair, but Telly liked the increased attention. He also liked strutting around in his Roman robes, both on and off the set.
Of course, no one was supposed to leave the studio in costume, but he did. And he drove a Lincoln Continental, drove into our modern apartment at the Park La Brea, took the elevator up, the Centurion, comes in the house, sits on the modern couch, and makes phone calls. And it was very disconcerting. I was sort of glad when he left, and usually I was not glad when he left.
In time, Telly did leave for months at a stretch as he took on more and more roles in Europe. He had a fear of flying and preferred boats and trains, always traveling first class. In London, he began visiting the casinos, developing a taste for gambling, especially the game of baccarat.
He would gamble his house, his family, his uncle, his aunt, his dog, if you have one. Now, he was big into gambling. Or some gamblers that get very uptight when they lose a great deal of money. He never showed that one way or the other. When he won, when he lost, he was always even-keeled, so to speak.
Cool gambler might have been Telly's reputation off-screen, but villain was becoming his image on-screen. In 1966, he played a sadistic French legionnaire in Beaugest. And And the next year, a homicidal GI named Maggot in the Dirty Dozen.
Scream.
Scream, you slut.
Spigot, you harlot. Scream. Spigot. Spigot, you.
In spite of his menacing appearance in the movies, Telly remained a loving, if sometimes absent, father and husband. While he liked the trips to Europe and the freedom they afforded, he missed his family, too.
Hello, my darling daughter, Penelope. I cannot tell you how happy I am when I receive your wonderful letters and drawings. They are so beautiful, and I am so very proud when I see how well you make letters like P and E. Please don't stop writing because Papa misses you very much. But pretty soon I will be coming home, and I will give you a great big hug and a squeeze. Give my love to Mama and Candace and to Hercules and all your pussycats. Love, Papa.
Family. It defined Telly. It was part of being Greek, and it was part of being a Savalas. For his kids and wives, Telly was the hub of a giant wheel, keeping them connected by centrifugal force.
I remember when we went to New York, we'd stay at Catherine's house, his first wife's house, and that's not customary that the children of the second wife stay in the home of the first wife.
When I did finally meet my new stepmother, the first thing she said to me was that it was very important to my father that I be a part of this new family and that we feel like a family, and we do.
In 1968, Telly's family joined him in Switzerland, where he was filming the James Bond movie on Her Majesty's Secret Service. He was portraying another villain, a role some might accuse him of playing in his personal life, too. For while his wife and children gathered around him, they did not suspect he was seeing another woman. At age 45, Telly had fallen in love with a 19-year-old actress named Sally Adams.
We were all together at the top of this mountain and shooting this movie, it seemed eternally. And so there was plenty of time to sit around and have dinner and talk and get to know one another. And he was charming. There was no one more charming and charismatic than Telly.
You gotta remember, the other ladies that were in Telly Savalas' life were much the home people. Sally was today's lady. She would party with Telly. She would go out to nightclubs. She would go out to the different dinners. She was in show business.
But we were very much in love. It was a very passionate, exciting relationship. Absolutely.
By 1973, Sally was carrying Telly's child. For 5 years, they'd kept the affair a secret. But now Sally wanted Telly to make a choice between his wife and her. He could no longer have it both ways, traveling back and forth across the Atlantic.
He was put in a position where I think that Sally was going to come to America whether he liked it or not. And because he always said he was blackmailed, you know, so he had to tell my mom.
I almost have a feeling that he wanted his life with this other woman and us too. And then when Kojak, it became evident that Kojak was going to be shot in the States, she was not about to stay in England.
Kojak, the role that would change Telly's life forever, was being offered to him just as his personal life was falling apart. Other actors had been considered, including Marlon Brando, but the role was Telly's for the taking. All he had to do was sign the contract, and he'd wake up a star.
New Day, Timothy Hutton, Maury Chapin, Three Perfect Murders.
It was 1972, and Telly Savalas was not a happy man. At age 48, he was still married, but with a mistress in London, who was now pregnant and threatening to move to the United States. Feeling trapped, Telly was being forced to choose between the family he loved and the woman he had fallen in love with. Meanwhile, he was being offered a TV movie called The Marcus Nelson Murders. If the movie was successful, it could spin off into a TV series, a prospect Telly was less than thrilled about.
Telly didn't want to do a series. He just didn't want to do a series. He said, I'll do The Marcus Nelson Murders, but I don't want to do a series. How could I do the one role? I mean, I have to have a variety of life. My life is a variety. I can't be stuck with one character. So maybe it won't sell.
With reservations, Telly signed on.
Sit down.
To play Theo Kojak, a New York detective who goes to bat for a black man hounded into a murder confession by the police.
Did a lot of talking to them, and now you're going to do a lot of talking to me.
He was a different kind of cop than we had ever seen before. I mean, he wasn't straight-laced. We had had before that the Jack Webb, all we want is the facts man. And here was a guy that was interested in people.
Make me believe you. Make me believe you're not telling a lie.
How can I do that?
Tell me what they said. Exactly what they said.
The Marcus Nelson murders was a huge success, delivering the fate Telly had dreaded. A TV series Wednesday nights on CBS called Kojak.
You're going to see a mortician if I hear a bang bang within 10 blocks of here. My lawyer, please. Get him in the car.
As Kojak, Telly played a tough but lovable cop with a take charge attitude, a lollipop, and a signature phrase heard round the world.
Who loves you, baby? You're beautiful.
He was my kind of guy. I just love that feeling of being with a man that's going to take care of everything.
For years, Telly had taken care of family members and friends, loaning them money and getting them jobs. On Kojak, he even gave his brother George a job playing the soft-spoken Detective Stavros. By the end of Kojak's first season in 1974, Telly was 51 and a household name.
I don't think he realized his notoriety and his fame. We went to see the Norton-Ali fight. He thought he could just pull up in his limousine through that crowd, you know, outside of Yankee Stadium. They were crazy about him. They started shaking the car, Kojak, Kojak, and I'm going, I told you you can't do this. You're a star, you idiot. You can't do this way.
Telly was mobbed by fans everywhere, and not just in America. Even the Queen of England was reported to be an avid Telly watcher.
Theo Kojak / Telly Savalas entered the TV detective genre at a time where everyone was a gimmick detective. We had a fat detective, which was Conan. We had an old detective, which was Barnaby Jones. We had a detective in a wheelchair who was Ironside. And at first, everybody was trying to fit Kojak into that mold by calling him the bald detective. But he was so much more than that, as evidenced by the fact that he won the Emmy for Best Actor in a TV series the first year he was on, which is very rare.
Telly's pop, classy surgeon and first return. It's Telly's pop. In front.
With stardom came new ambitions, including ownership of a racehorse named Telly's Pop, and a shot at being a singer. Telly cut an album, and then three more.
Well, the singing is up for grabs. I mean, let's put it this way. Pavarotti doesn't have a thread on his hands.
It didn't matter that Telly couldn't sing. He thought he could, and so did the people who paid to see him in Las Vegas.
But then I'll come your way. Turn your blackest night into day. When you're needing it bad, cause some rough times you've had, I'm gonna look at you and I'm gonna say, who loves you, baby?
And Telly's on all the time. I mean, he's doing the whole show with dancing girls, with special lighting effects. And who's in the audience? Frank Sinatra. Telly singing a Sinatra, his idol as a kid. I'm singing a Sinatra. Hey, what are we talking about? It's amazing.
Sammy Davis Jr. used to tease Dean Martin. We used to tease him about that. You have a nightclub act? You're Kojak. What are you doing, you know?
It was the 1970s. And Telly was not only riding the zeitgeist, he was singing it.
Baby, baby, won't you tell me what I want to know? you tell me, tell me what I want to know.
By the end of Kojak's first season, Telly had divorced Lynn and moved in with Sally Adams. The stormy relationship produced a son, Nicholas, who was as strong-willed as his father. Theirs was not an easy relationship, fueled in part by Telly's fights with Sally.
We would butt heads every now and then. I'm sure he saw a lot of himself in me, maybe.
Finally, in 1976, Telly and Sally split up. He had wanted to marry her, but she feared becoming just another one of Telly's wives. He was 53, and as Kojak entered its fifth season, the show was losing popularity. It didn't take a detective to figure out that no amount of gold chains, cool shades, or lollipops could prepare Telly for what would come next.
Biography's look at Telly Savalas will continue in a moment. But first, who's your...
Kevin, Telly Savalas was at the peak of his career. Kojak, the television series he had made popular with his signature phrase, "Who loves you, baby?", was seen in over 70 countries. Visitors to the set would often find Telly holding court. And when the visitor was an attractive woman, he couldn't resist trying to seduce her, even during an interview.
Are you a mother, Pat?
No, I'm not, no.
I make great babies, kid. I really do.
Yes?
Great kids.
Well, send your references and a resume, and we'll look it over.
You and me combined, we'd make either a princess or an emperor. Nothing short of that, kid. Huh?
I just want to have one that will do a lot of commercials. You know, some little kid that does a jam commercial, and then I can retire.
But you're not romantic when you say things like that. First, where we'll start, we know we'll have a lot of fun making the kids. And then it all begins. And we'll raise them, and love them, and kick them because we love them.
Only if you promise to do the diapers. I'll do everything else.
You got a deal, baby.
Okay.
You got a deal.
By 1978, Kojak had been on the air for 5 years. It had been a huge success, but now Telly's charms were wearing thin, and the series was canceled after 110 episodes. Overnight, Telly became just another actor, though a famous one, looking for work.
There was a little bit of a lull. And when you went to a producer and you said, "Telly Savalas," say, "Oh, Kojak, well, he's too identified. He's too identified."
In 1984, Telly returned as Theo Kojak in a series of TV specials, but it was obvious to everyone that both actor and cop were tired. After the fourth episode, plans were dropped for producing more.
When the show was canceled, I came to him and I said, Telly, this is sad, man. You know what he said to me? Vince, it's somebody else's turn.
All of a sudden, when there was no Kojak, suddenly, like it is in this business, people started to lose interest in Telly. I felt, that he was like a kid and who had a great toy, and suddenly somebody took away that toy. And it was sad because I could think of all the wonderful things he could have done. He was capable of that.
Telly had sometimes picked his roles because of money or travel or the chance to gamble. Like all actors, he turned down parts that maybe he should have taken.
A friend of his had asked him to do them a favor, to do a movie. And he said, "Yes, of course I'll do that." And in doing so, turned down Patton. And as you know, George C. Scott wound up doing it. And one of the reviews was a wonderful movie. George C. Scott was wonderful, doing an amazing impression of Telly Savalas playing Patton.
Telly spent the rest of the 1980s and early 90s acting in TV movies and mediocre motion pictures, mostly overseas. And for the fourth time in his life, he started a new family. Her name was Julie Hovland, and Telly had met her in 1977 during his last year of Kojak. She was a travel agent from Minnesota on vacation with her mother and aunt when Telly invited them for a drink at the Sheraton Universal Hotel, where he now lived.
He'd kiss their hands, he'd tell them how pretty they were, and he was like that. He was just so wonderful. And women felt beautiful around Telly.
A few months later, Julie moved in with Telly. He was 54, she only 20. By the time he was 60, Telly was a father again, with a son named Christian and a daughter, Ariana. But with the new family had come loss. In 1985, Telly's brother George died from leukemia. George had been driving a taxi when Telly gave him the role of Detective Stavros in Kojak. Then in 1989, Telly's mother, Christina, died, and Telly was overheard saying he felt like an orphan. That same year, Telly found the first evidence of bladder cancer, the disease that had killed his father. Afraid of the implications, he delayed seeking help.
Well, I said, Telly, see a doctor, for God's sakes. He says, forget about it. It's gone now. This is a month ago.
By the time Telly sought treatment, it was too late. He was 70 and going to die. But he refused to admit it, and no one was allowed to suggest otherwise.
I think there was a lot of things that he was uncomfortable talking about. I think he was comfortable staying in that persona and keeping people at a distance, and he liked it like that way. Nobody too close.
Telly may have been a private man, but he never stopped being a family man. In his last days, the family he loved and sometimes had betrayed gathered to say goodbye.
We were all around him. I know Gus was there. Nicholas was there. Catherine was there, his first wife. Sally came. It was mostly women in true Greek fashion. We were all around his bed.
We were all there because we cared deeply and we loved him.
On January 22nd, 1994, one day after his 71st birthday, Telly Savalas died. In life, he had held a disparate family of ex-wives and children together. In death, he sowed the seeds for its disintegration. The source of contention would be Telly's will, valued at $6 million. It would split the family, pitting his widow Julie against the others. As for Telly's final legacy, it must be found amongst the many roles he played, both on screen and off.
Telly Savalas was one of a kind. I mean, I don't think there's anybody around today that you can compare, that I can.
I'm very, very proud to be his daughter. Not because of any of his acting, but because of the father that he was.
It's true that I've been blessed.
I think his legacy as an actor is that he paved the way for many of our other actors who would have never darkened a studio soundstage because they just were not beautiful enough.
I think you could give my father and the popularity of Kojak credit for making it cool to identify with your ethnicity. All of a sudden, having an ethnic name became okay, and being of any kind of ethnic background was okay.
It wouldn't surprise me at all that when we get to the pearly gates, that Kojak might be there. And it wouldn't surprise me at all that when we got to the gates of hell, that Kojak would also be there. I think he would be as at home in heaven as he was in hell. And that was the great ability and power of Telly Savalas.
For today's generation, the 1970s seem like ancient history. But for those who lived it, they remember a time full of turmoil and change. A time when people begged for heroes and found one on TV, thanks to a bald guy with a lollipop and a signature phrase.
Who loves you, baby?
Who loves your baby?
Who loves you, baby?
Who loves you, baby?
Who loves your baby?
Who loves you, baby?
Who loves you, baby? We'll always love you, Telly.
I had the chance to work with Telly Savalas a few times, both on Kojak, the series, and in a 1991 TV movie. But my work with Telly actually goes farther back than that, all the way back to 1961, when we both appeared in a film called Mad Dog Cole, about a gangland killer. I had other chances to work with Telly. After the shooting of Kojak moved to California, they came back to New York once for a two-hour season opener. We were filming on one of the piers by the Hudson River, and the QE2 sailed by in the background, and one of the grips yelled, "Match that on the back lot of Universal." Tomorrow on Biography, Watching the Detectives Week continues with Pepper Anderson, alias Angie Dickinson, liberated, tough, policewoman Angie Dickinson, Wednesday.